how do you feel about how far we've come and your part in it?
It's like a dream, Kathy. It really is. I'm just so blessed that we've had all the opportunities that have come our way, and they're still coming. And God loves animals, and He is in this, I am assured. I'm Denise Goodson, native of Asheville or Buncombe County, North Carolina. My forefathers were some of the first settlers here in Asheville. All my life I have loved animals. My mother is the one that touched my heart, because in our neighborhood we were the place where stray animals ended up at our house. And that started me off loving them like I did, and still do. I had been writing letters to the editor about my pain, knowing what was going on over at the animal shelter. We called it the pound back then. And I was writing letters to the editor. Interesting, a lady across town's little dog that was on medication got out of its yard, ended up at the shelter. Her name was Ilse Knight. I can't remember the little dog's name. It ended up at the shelter, and just in like a day, it was put to sleep because it had health problems. She didn't even have time to find it or look for it.
And this was back in?
This was in about 1980. Around 1980. She got in touch with me because she was so upset about what had happened to her, and she says, what can we do about this? And I said, let's get a group together and form, try to go to the commissioners and get them to do something about what was going on. So she and I got a group of people together, and we met, I can't remember where we met, but we were called Concerned Citizens for Animals. And we were together for a few years, and then some of us left Concerned Citizens for Animals. We weren't having any luck doing what we wanted to accomplish, and formed Buncombe County Humane Society. We thought we would form that group to try to encourage the shelter, since we had Buncombe County on the name, we would try to encourage the shelter employees to treat animals more humanely. We wanted to try to encourage them to have a little bit more time for an animal to be there before it was destroyed, and to change the reasons why they would destroy an animal without even trying to get in touch with its owner before they destroyed it. Back then, the shelter was awful. They were putting animals to sleep, or euthanizing them, in a gas chamber made out of an automobile exhaust. They were putting dogs and cats, males and females, all in the same place. They were scared to death. I know they were scared to death. I would lay asleep at night, not being able to sleep, thinking about tomorrow they're going to be stuffing them in those chambers. I went through such a hard time with my personal life, because I knew what was going on. People would show up at the shelter and just throw animals across the fence. They would throw them across the fence in the rain. The shelter was a place where you just dump unwanted animals. It started out as a animal control, is what it started out as, animal control. But they didn't really try to find owners or anything. They just collected them. And I think they had a truck that went out with a noose on the end when someone would call and report a stray animal, and they'd go collect it and take it to the shelter. And most animals got put to sleep because they didn't have any kind of adoption going on. It wasn't really their fault. They were doing the best they could, but they had no training on animal care. And so Buncombe County Humane Society tried to get involved with the Buncombe County Commissioners. We would show up at the commission meetings on a regular basis. We also would have little cocktail parties and invite them out to try to discourage them from going down that path and try to train them or try to influence them on how to care for animals. We used to do Pet Adoption Day. Friends for Animals did. We would go over to the radio station and they would talk to us on the radio and talk about big Pet Adoption Day coming up. We would do Pet Adoption Day and clean out the shelter every time we did it because our heart ached for the animals that were stuck over there. We used River Ridge Shopping Center parking lot and would even put on a fashion show with animals, with the models. We used Biltmore Estate as a fashion show site with animals. We went everywhere we could and took animals with us. We even took them to the county commissioners meetings when we'd go there. Every Saturday seems to me like we would be somewhere doing a pet adoption day. But the one at River Ridge Shopping Center was the biggest. We would have at least 100 animals there that they would cart to the site. Our people in their own vehicles. We had people. Yeah, they'd go to the shelter and get them. Some of our members had horse wagons. Some of them had pickup trucks. Some of them just stuffed them in their cars. We would get them to River Ridge the best way we could and adopt every one of them. But we would also, back then, we would tell them they need to, how important it is to spay and neuter their animals. But we were finding out that a lot of the animals were not being spayed and neutered. They would promise to spay and neuter, but they wouldn't follow up. So we decided to spay and neuter the animals before they went out of the shelter. That was a big, giant step. I, with another couple of people, Nancy Lyles, Pam Ivey, and Debbie Mitchell, who were members of Buncombe County Humane Society, we decided that we wanted to do more. We wanted to build our own shelter instead of depending on a county-run shelter. We knew that it was going to take a lot of money. But back then, we thought, surely $1 million would start us off, because we had a pretty good membership base. So we started raising money. We got a lot of $1,000 donations. And we started meeting. We tried to pull in people who were animal lovers mixed with people who were movers and shakers as well. We were a working board of directors. And we talked on the phone every day. And we loved our work, our job. We were always at the shelter bathing animals, grooming animals, walking them. We were always planning fundraisers. We wrote letters to our supporters on a regular basis. You got to do that. You got to let them know that you appreciate what they're doing and what they give as a result. Our newsletter, which was printed many times by the Asheville Citizen Times as an insert. Everyone who subscribed to the Citizen Times got our newsletter, and that brought in lots of support and financial donation. We also had the anti-cruelty walk, which was headed up by Marilyn Walker, who founded that walk. And we had it every year on Be Kind to Animals Week.
I got involved with the Friends for Animals, now known as the Asheville Humane Society. I was at Belle Chair, and there was a booth there, and promoting Friends for Animals, and a lady named Denise Goodson, that the whole county knows now, asked for a donation, and that's when I kind of said, okay, I'll give a donation, and that's as far as I thought it would go, but we got to talking, and she found out I worked for the newspaper in my hometown, and she rounded me up and said, we need you to get involved. From there, I became extremely involved in Friends for Animals by way of writing for the Paw Prints newsletter. I was the nominating committee chair. Every time they needed someone to head up a committee, Marilyn did it, but I was really, really excited about what they were doing and where they were going, and I wanted to go with them. And the reason I wanted to be on the board of directors is, at the time, Buncombe County had not shined the light very much on animal cruelty that was going on in this county. And I wanted something done about it, and I wanted a public awareness. I was asked to chair the fundraising committee. The very first walk was at the County Plaza, and we had about 75 walkers. I had just, got the board to get out and grab whoever loved animals and say, hey, we're going to have our very first walk here in downtown Asheville and get all your friends and neighbors and relatives or whoever has a dog, and let's do this. We raised about $1,500. I had no idea, like I say at the time, that it would get as big as it did. And then fast forward to the 13th walk, and we had over 500 registrants, 500 walkers at the Biltmore estate. We raised over $55,000. And I'm getting cold chills just thinking about it from that little simple walk. Buncombe County was instrumental, to say the least, in where this walk came. And one of the people that I'd like to brag on is our own chairman of the county commissioners, and that's my buddy David Gant. He was always there to support this walk. He was there, he and I would head off the walk, and he promoted it. He talked about it everywhere he went. He would wear the t-shirts out to promote it. So he was, like I say, very instrumental in getting this walk and the fundraising, which snowballed and later developed into, I would like to say, in part, the shelter and the adoption center and the focus on cruelty investigations and people reporting cruelty. It's been phenomenal.
See, I had lupus at the time when this was going on. And so I started praying for God to send help. And Bill McKelvey came on the scene. I met him for lunch one day through a friend of mine, or a friend of his, and just boo-hooed over my plate of food and asked him to please come on board, because I knew that he had the business mind that we needed. And I was having problems dealing with my medical problem and couldn't even put a sentence together back then. So he came on and did the paperwork and the everything that had to be done. He became my shadow.
I had lunch with Denise and Barbara Wilcoxon, who was one of the original drafters of before Friends for Animals. And they asked me if I would help them raise money to build a new animal shelter. And I'm a new kid in town. I didn't belong to any fraternal organization. I didn't go to in UNC. I'm not even a church affiliate. I'm a new kid in town. But I said, I'll do what I can. I went down to the shelter to view the shelter prior to its opening, when they were euthanizing animals. And what I saw was a cement block box hooked up to a truck motor, where the animal control officers threw mixed bags where it said, definitely do not put wounded animals, cats or dogs, and no more than three large ones. Anyway, they were not paying attention to any rules I could see that were written. And it took 20 minutes, and I thought they were going to asphyxiate the people in the shelter by the time they got the animals put down. Well, we hounded the county commissioners and hounded. And this is probably the best part of what I can say about Buncombe County. Well, now that I'm here and with the Humane Alliance, I mean, I just go on, and it's just been magnificent. And what's occurred with the Asheville Humane Society and the new buildings is fantastic. Nowhere, it's a showplace for the rest of the country. It really is. But there was a point where we got under the commissioner's skin to the point where they came to me and they said, Bill, would you and Friends for Animals like to take over the management of the animal shelter? Now, there wasn't any member of the board of Friends for Animals that wanted to kill animals. But we understood that if we took over the management of the shelter, the first thing we did was remove that cement and move to lethal injection, which is the most humane. The other half of that was, I did not enjoy, nor did the directors, going down the cage lines and selecting 30 animals a day to kill the next day, to make room for the next 30. And the statistics proved out, or the statistics were, that in Western North Carolina, the ownership of animals was 3 times the national average. So there was no end in sight to what we were doing. And picking out animals that were perfectly healthy and adoptable and having to euthanize them the next, when they weren't adopted. And there weren't enough homes. There still aren't enough homes. People say to me, you must have a great passion for animals. And in truth, I didn't have a great passion for animals. I did have a great passion for those people who were trying so hard to take care of these animals. And so what I was doing, I was putting the head on the heart of all of these humane organizations that I served on the boards of in Western North Carolina, forming their 501c3s.
So.
It was an unbelievable experience. In 1994, I understood, I probably understood a long time before, but I was picking up, actually, before 1994, I was actually picking up animals in parking lots of Kmart and wherever, and transporting them down to Greenville, South Carolina, where I was on the board of directors. And they had a freestanding spay-neuter clinic. So I was spay-neutering animals from Buncombe County, transporting them to Greenville, South Carolina, and bringing them back. I understood what I should do was duplicate that effort. So in 94, I went in search of funds to open up a nonprofit, high volume, low cost spay neuter clinic, because that's the only answer. If you don't stop them from breeding, there is no way that you can stop from putting them down. There just aren't enough homes. To take over, if you will, the management of the shelter was one of the most critical things that ever happened to us. And it couldn't have happened if it weren't for the county commissioners, their foresight and their willingness to bite the bullet. And they really had to bite a tough bullet, because they had to find jobs for people who had jobs for 100 years. They said, we'll give it a try. And that is really terrific. That was really the turning point. When the county commissioners came to me and asked me if Friends for Animals would take over the management of the animal shelter. The shelter was what it was. I was on the roof tar papering the holes to keep the water from dripping in, bringing a salamander down to heat to heat the shelter when the electricity went off. People who have never seen that shelter, I mean, it was a garage 80 years before it became a shelter. And a very, very difficult situation to run and manage. I convinced the board that instead of looking for a director who would work for $30,000 a year, we needed to outline what kind of a director we needed, what we expected from that director. And it was a lengthy, it was, I mean, I remember writing what we wanted to have that director do, and it was significant. And I just happened to have found, when I was at a convention, a young man who fit that bill. His name was Mark Paulus, past vice president of the Humane Society of the United States in charge of companion animals, and also vice president in charge later of equine services worldwide for HSUS. But he had a background that started in animal cruelty investigation in Florida 100 years ago before he moved up through the ranks to being the vice president of the Humane Society of the United States. So he knew his shit. But we couldn't afford him. But I found a way through another saint that appeared, and she said, I think I have a person who will give us the money to be able to hire Mr. Paulus and bring him here to work. And Mark was absolutely remarkable. The only problem about Mark was it was his way or the highway. I love the deal, but he was the smartest man, and without him, he set up all the programs. He set up Chameleon. He set the standards for the animal shelter.
I started in 1999, and I came from a long career with the Humane Society of the United States, most recently in Washington, D.C., as Vice President for Companion Animals. So I was looking for a new challenge and a more direct, hands-on approach with animals. So I came to Buncombe County and what was then Buncombe County Friends for Animals, later became Asheville Humane Society. But it was a very interesting transition because I very quickly learned in my previous job it really was all about animals and animal care and animal rescue and animal advocacy in a very direct way towards legislation and whatever. And in Buncombe County, it became all about people. It became about people management, not just in the shelter, but in the community, because there are so many people with very, very different ideas on what they wanted from community animal control, from volunteering at the animal shelter. And so it was an interesting transition. Actually, the challenge I was looking for is to take a program that had been inadequately funded, that didn't have a model shelter by any stretch of the imagination, didn't have really trained staff that had had the opportunity to go to conferences and training programs, and to try to transform that into a modern animal shelter. I did, but there was a lot of kicking and screaming and gnashing of teeth and pain and letters to the editor, and you know, it wasn't an easy or painless transition. And things that you would never expect to encounter. Were oddly controversial. The choice of which dog food to feed the animals was, you know, one of these major battles that we had. For example, there's generally a belief that animal shelters should try to save money whenever possible by cutting costs in seemingly good areas. An example would be getting broken bags of food from, you know, local grocery stores. It would seem to be a good idea because you pay little or nothing for these bags of food. But the problem is that in an animal shelter, it gives the dogs diarrhea if you don't feed the same food all the time, especially if you feed cheap dog foods that have a high amount of inedible fillers, maybe peanut shells or something like that in there. So what happens is all the animals get diarrhea. Then you spend a lot more money and time cleaning up after them than if you fed high quality food that didn't cause diarrhea and that you didn't change every other day. So just trying to get the volunteers aware of the fact that I really no longer wanted old bags of food. It was a painful transition. We had to impose a rule about walking. You know, volunteers love to come in and interact with the animals, and it's very, very good, usually. Some of the problems can be that we really don't know anything about their health status, and we certainly don't know anything about their temperament when they first come into an animal shelter. So it takes a few days to evaluate the animal's behavior and know that they're safe to be handled, that they've been at, you know, and there are some people that are good at reading animal behavior, and some folks are, quite frankly, they're bite magnets. You know, they don't understand when the animal is growling that perhaps it doesn't want to be picked up, you know. So, you know, we had to institute training programs, again, just for everyday handling issues, to protect people that very much wanted to help us and interact with animals, and also to protect animals. Another example that we ran into is, it's very, very natural for people to want to go up to a pen, put their fingers in, open the door, and then hug the animal. Now, in the case of a puppy, for example, that hug can be the embrace of death, simply because you hug one four cages down that might have been incubating a disease. You embrace that to your chest, you contaminated your clothing, and you walk down the aisle and you continue to embrace animals. So it was challenging to tell people that, first of all, don't hold them to your clothing. Hold them outward or play with them on the floors, and then wash your hands between animals, because we don't see bugs, you know, we don't see those kinds of germs, and those are some of the challenges that we ran into, and balancing my perhaps obsessive concern about the health of the animals against the very natural concern that people had. They wanted to have a pleasant interaction at the animal shelter. So I learned a lot I learned more about human behavior than I learned about animal behavior in the job, because I already knew that part. I didn't know all of the challenges that we would have with people. Altogether, I have to tell you, it was a good experience, a real learning experience for me. I was able to bring about the policies and procedures that really turned around the animal shelter. I guess I would have to say that my 2-year period of time as the director of the animal shelter was a period of great change and transition. And, you know, from my perspective, most of it was necessary. Not all of it was appreciated. You know? But that's, you know, that's part and parcel of the job. I think what's heartening is that the changes have endured, and that my successors have not only built upon the things that I was able to accomplish, but have done so much more.
The reason Asheville Humane Society exists is because Mark understood that Friends for Animals, without having the name Humane Society in it, we would be locked out of any court proceedings where money was left to animal welfare organizations, humane organizations. So Mark did a DBA of Asheville Humane Society. That's when I decided I had the best there was, and I could move on to opening a high volume, low cost spayed neuter clinic.
Denise and I said, you know, it's time we get a new animal shelter and the focus be on education, spaying and neutering. And we didn't know they could do pediatric spays and neuters. I mean, you know, the best was yet to come. And but they need to do that. And it was funny, when we went to the new shelter, we just sat there, both of us, our eyes welling up, and said, remember our conversation when we said it has to be about education and respecting animal life and spaying and neutering and making the animal valuable, you know, and in a heart level and making a part of a family. We need a whole new concept. We need a whole new mindset. And of course, you know, I Denise Goodson. Anybody that's known Denise Goodson realizes this woman, once she gets something in her head, it ain't going anywhere until it's done.
Thank goodness for Ann and Bob Lewis, who gave the property for the shelter. They had been involved previously and were one of our major donors.
The moment we've all been waiting for. Let the dogs dig.
Along with Nancy Lyles, who's one of the founders, and Marilyn Walker, who took up the pet anti-cruelty walk, who's a major player. We were recognized as a group. We would have liked to have said something. I especially would have loved to have said something, but time did not permit that. But our hearts were beating inside our shirts. We were so excited.
Folks, this has been a long time coming. You think? And I'd like to thank my colleagues that decided this was a priority for this year. This is a exciting, long-awaited, overdue time for all of us. And it's past time to replace that disgraceful facility that we used. Yeah. And you used so well, but let's face it, it wasn't what we can do better than that. We're going to do better than that from now on. Buncombe County is a national leader in animal welfare. We have a model for spay neuter that's copied all over the country. Yeah. We have a model, a countdown to zero, where we are going to promise you we're going to work with every nonprofit to make sure we don't kill animals when we don't need to. We're gonna work for a balance between the homeless animals and the homes that they're gonna live in from now on. And wouldn't it be a great thing in 20 years, instead of talking about building maybe a new facility for more animals, we're talking about how we don't need this because we've got that balance and we're not killing any animals and there are no homeless animals in Buncombe County. We're going to have the highest level of animal care, code enforcement, public health and safety, and we're going to give each one of these dogs the best chance they have, and dogs, cats, and any other kind of animal, the best chance possible to match them with a home that's going to love them and raise them in a way that we would want all of God's creatures to be taken care of.
Asheville Buncombe is a wonderful place to live for human beings, and of course AB Tech has been dedicated to students all of its 50 years of existence. And what's nice about being dedicated to students is those students, and some of them are in the back, and if you're an AB Tech student back there, how about raising your hand so you can see them? Our students represent a wide diversity of what this community is all about, and part of that is caring for students, but it's also people who care for animals. And we are very proud to be able to participate as a partner and a collaborator in this initiative. We have a very strong vet tech program. Many students have been in for a couple of years now. We have a very strong class. I think I heard 48 students this coming year, which is wonderful. We expect to be a participant and a collaborator with the county for years to come. We also appreciate the support of the commissioners and all they do on behalf of the college, but also on behalf of letting us do partnerships like this, which actually for us, when we've got a growing college, the opportunity to conduct classes out here and to have a program here is tremendous.
What a wonderful day to see this to come to fruition. And it's been through the efforts of more people than we could ever name here today to bring this animal shelter about. Animal control is probably one of the toughest jobs we have at the Sheriff's Office. And it's a very pivotal part of the plan to make sure that the commissioners, as the commissioners say, that we never euthanize any more healthy animals. And we work towards that goal every day. And one part of that goal is education and enforcement of making sure that people spay and neuter their animals and we do the things that we need to do to get there. I think of what it says about our community as much as anything is how we treat our animals. And I think this shelter is going to be very successful and we're going to move forward with our community partnerships to make sure that we have good success here.
This is certainly a pleasure. We were here for the groundbreaking ceremony at a little muddy field. We're trying to figure out exactly where everything was and where it went. And this is a marvelous layout, well needed, well done, and well represented today. Just look at the crowd that we have here.
You know, 25 years ago, a group of dedicated citizens dreamed a dream. They founded what is now Asheville Humane Society. And they changed the future for Buncombe County's homeless animals. I hope some of these original board members are here today, and I see you are. And I hope these buildings surpass their greatest dreams. An animal care campus that unites in one place the compassion, resources, and vision of four committed groups. First, private philanthropists dedicated to saving lives through sheltering, adoption, and education. Next, an enlightened, supportive county commission that put its money where its heart is. Law enforcement officials are here today. Sheriff Duncan, they put their lives on the line to protect the public and to protect the animals. And finally, the educators at AB Tech, Hank Dunn, Max Queen, others, that are going to provide veterinary technician education here for the future. Now here's where it gets a little harder for me to find adequate words for my thanks to our donors who left animals enough to dig deep and come up with over $3 million in a time of recession to build the Asheville Humane Society Adoption and Education Center.
It's wonderful. It's wonderful. I love going there. But it is a no-kill shelter, which is great, but a no-kill shelter can only take so many animals and then they have to stop. So we've got to keep supporting what we have. It's a wonderful thing and we can't let it disappear. We've got to keep going. Buncombe County has become one of the nation's leaders in animal welfare as a result of our shelter.
When I look at the shelter now, and the county shelter, the animal control division, I tell you what, I can't believe it. It's everything we dreamed of. It's absolutely everything we dreamed of. And to think it's here in Asheville, and I know Denise and I, we had Debbie Mitchell with us, and unfortunately Pam wasn't with us. And it was like, can you believe this? You know, we would walk through and there was a room for educating. Of course, there's the spay-neuter programs. There's the thing like the animals are living as if they're in a home. Because, you know, the shelter's not their home. But you got to prepare them when they go home. So, you know, you take care of them until then. And I saw this loving staff that no longer looked like, oh my gosh, another day of this. And then put on the smile and go take care of these dirty little creatures. I saw, you know, big old ugly goofy dogs being just premiered in these beautiful rooms with glass and people couldn't wait to get in and touch them. And I have to say, I've done a lot of things in my life that I've enjoyed and I've had pride with, but being a part of what I'm seeing over there now is, you know, I don't know, I think that's one of my proudest things I've done. And I just feel very honored to have been included in on that. And the people that are there now, I know Catherine McGowan and Jim Fulton and other staff members. Oh my gosh. I mean, these people truly love what they do. Beautiful. I mean, it is absolutely beautiful. I used to hear the reason people would say they did not adopt from the shelters, I can't go in there and look because I can't take them all home. I can't make the decision, blah, blah. That is not a concern anymore. If you can go into a pet store, which I don't think people should get animals from, but if you can go into a pet store, you can go in this place and leave happy. And you know that whatever you saw is going to be in a home soon, but or they're going to be there still going through their paces. And even over where you won't be going, where the county's taking in animals, and they still have that same battle we had. You know, people can't, they can't just say, oh, it's solved. It's not solved until people stop making these animals. But when you go over there, once again, you have caring, loving people that even sometimes you have animals that don't have a chance, and they are making their last moments precious, and they're trying to educate people who are coming in to reclaim their animals, you know? So I just think this really takes Asheville to a whole new level. I mean, our buildings are beautiful. Our streets are looking great. I love the, you know, we're green. But we're actually caring for our animals now.
I'm no longer involved myself, but I'm very proud of what has been achieved. And I had a very tiny part in it, but it was a part that resulted in something that was is really a grand dream. And it's there. And it's something the entire community can be proud of. Absolutely. For a long time to come.
I mean, this new shelter is just absolutely fantastic. I think it's the best in the state of North Carolina. I'd go so far as to say it's the best in the Southeast in terms of intelligent design of features, traffic flow, disease control, and just it's generally an inviting atmosphere for the public to come in and see. So I was glad to have at least planted the seed for that, you know, get things going.
And Buncombe County should be so proud of itself. And the commissioners that were there that took the chance on privatizing essentially the management of the shelter, that really set the stage for what it is today.
How do you feel about how far we've come and your part in it?
It's like a dream, Kathy. It really is. I'm just so blessed that we've had all the opportunities that have come our way, and they're still coming. And God loves animals, and He is in this, I am assured.
Never gave up, and a lot of us came, we volunteered, we worked hard for a point of time, and sometimes we got discouraged, sometimes we left, and sometimes we came back, but there was a core of people who never gave up. They were always in there fighting for the cause and putting up with the problems and difficulties along the way. And So those are the people that I'm proudest of.
I am so excited about this letter. Bill McKelvey and myself both got one of these, and it was given to us in 1992 from Buncombe County commissioners. They appointed us as lifetime watchdogs for the Buncombe County Animal Shelter, and we're going to be after you. Yes, we do take it seriously. We'll be checking in and out there on a regular basis. Not that we need to, but we love having this. And this hangs in a prominent place in my house, and I look at it every day. And I'm just so thankful to the commissioners. They've been there with us from the very beginning, and they continue.